My name is Roger Härtl, and I would like to talk to you today about lateral interbody fusion, which is really one of the most exciting developments in minimally invasive spinal surgery over the last 15 years or so. And as spinal surgeons, as we decide what we have to do in order to treat patient symptoms, lateral interbody fusion allows us a lot of options in terms of fusion. So one goal of doing a lateral interbody fusion, of course, is to achieve fusion. The second goal frequently is some type of deformity correction. And the third goal, which I want to focus on today, is really indirect decompression. When it comes to indirect decompression, this is not something that is really new. Indirect decompression with ALIF surgery has been described in the 80s. And people did myelograms and saw that they got wonderful decompression of the central canal and also of the foramen. And that was then translated into lateral approaches, and that's what we're using today in a lot of our patients. We've seen over the years that if we want to quantify, on average, the amount of indirect decompression that we can expect is about 20 to 25% if you measure the volume of the central canal and the foramenal stenosis. The challenge, however, is that this is not always going to happen, and we want to predict in a patient before operating and before deciding on an operative plan. Ideally, we want to predict who is the patient who is really going to respond to indirect decompression and who is a patient who may also need direct decompression done at the same time. There are, as you know, there are a lot of reports of surgeries that are being done, and then patients stage surgeries, and they have patients walk around after lateral interbody fusion to see if the symptoms have resolved, and then they will make a decision as to whether or not a direct decompression is also necessary. And I always felt that that was very unsatisfying and obviously problematic to explain to a patient that you may have to do that. So ideally, we want to be in a situation as a spine surgeon where we look at the patient, we look at the films, we look at the symptoms, and we can make a fairly definitive decision before surgery. Is this patient going to respond to an indirect decompression, or do we also need a direct decompression? Now, we've looked at that, and others obviously have looked at that as well, and if we want to predict the success or failure of indirect decompression, there are patient factors, and then there are procedure factors. The patient factors are essentially the findings on imaging studies, the degree of disc collapse, the degree of lumbar spinal stenosis, the status of the facets, and the presence of lateral recess stenosis. Those are, for the most part, the most important patient factors that go into the equation. If you look at the procedure factors, we look at the size of the cage, the width, the length, the height of the cage. We look at the side of the approach from the convexity, from the concavity, from the right side, from the left side. And then there are other factors such as positioning of the cage, more anteriorly versus posteriorly. Does that have an impact on the quality and the degree of indirect decompression? And also on the lordosis of the cage, for example. So we've got patient factors, we've got procedure factors. If you look at the literature, it turns out that the most important factors that really predict indirect decompression or the success of indirect decompression appears to be the width of the cage. And that is very important because when I started doing these procedures, and as many other surgeons, I always felt that the height would be very important, but the height is actually not that important. The most important thing is when you do these procedures and you want to achieve sustainable indirect decompression is really the width. So I will try in these patients now always to put in the widest possible cage, and that makes surgery actually much safer because if you're trying, for example, to put in a very tall cage, the chances are much higher that you may get end plate disruption and so forth. In terms of patient factors, it turns out that the one pathology that we're not really good at treating with indirect decompression is severe lateral recess stenosis. That can be from degenerative processes, an overgrown facet joint. On the other hand, the degree of lumbar stenosis, the status of the facet joint per se, and the disc height don't seem to make that much of an impact on the success or failure of indirect decompression. So in summary, when I look at these patients, I will always try to use the widest possible cage if indirect decompression is important in this particular surgery, and I will look at the lateral recess. That said, there are cases where you do a lateral interbody fusion and you still think, well, I probably should still add the indirect decompression. And we can do that now with single-stage surgery meaning we do the lateral surgery, we put in the screws in a lateral position, and then even in the lateral position, we can drop a tube, and at the appropriate level, we can add a direct decompression to the lateral interbody fusion in a single-stage operation. And I think that's really exciting because that cuts down on the duration of the surgery. It makes staging of the surgery unnecessary, and it gives you the comfort as a surgeon in your office when you see the patient and when you tell the patient what type of surgery you're going to pick, to tell the patient that this is really going to work, that indirect decompression is going to be successful, and they're going to have a full resolution of their symptoms, which is obviously the goal. Thank you.